Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Quoit Pits. This evening, we're going to be talking about the World Quoit Tournament that ended last weekend. We have the two winners with us. Gentleman on my left, far left, his name is Scott Hall, and his partner next to him, Dan Carter. And just as a reminder, we intend to take some phone calls later in the show, towards the end of the show. So if anyone is interested in giving a call, if they want to know more about the program, more about quoiting and how to enter some of the tournaments and things, please don't hesitate to call in. We'd be happy to, you know, try and help you. Okay? So, gentlemen, any comments on how difficult it was to go from the beginning to the end of the tournament and, you know, finish on top? But I think it's your second win, is that correct?
Yes, it is.
Second time as world champions.
Yeah.
Okay, yep. It's incredible. It's very difficult to, you know, to go that far like you guys do. And, you know, I know you do it with a lot of ringers and, you know, topping other people's ringers. It's when I pitched, which was, you know, a number of years ago, I barely threw ringers at all. I was very defensive and standing quoits up, trying to block ringer throwers, but doesn't seem like anyone's doing that these days. So
we remember that.
The ringer throwers, the ringer throwers are definitely, you know, in charge, and those guys that can top, they get the big points, and the games end quickly sometimes.
Yeah, you got to be able to throw ringers nowadays. It's no longer a points game.
No, it's amazing. You know, it's 21 feet, and the hole in the quoit is only so big, but it's amazing how many times, you know, how accurate some people can be, and they put it on. It's just amazing.
Yeah,
but it's neat. That's such the challenge. And then, of course, the comradeship of playing against friends and you know, going back and forth and trying to get in their head for a little bit, and they try to get in your head. And, you know, it's a mental game as well, like a lot of games are, like golf and so forth. But, you know, it's very, you know, very psychological, you know, and a whole lot of fun at the same time.
So, yeah, you know, those first couple games you get into, you're always nervous. And,
right.
You know, my heart starts beating.
Yeah, right in the finals, definitely.
You just don't know what to expect. And, you know, you're hoping you have it that day. And, you know, you guys generally have it almost every time, which is why you keep winning tournaments. But that's great. And there's a lot of players out there. I mean, to go from beginning to end, you've got 10 games of pool play. And then you've got best of three playoffs for 4, 5, or 6 rounds till you get to the end.
Yeah.
It might be 90 or 95 degrees out. You're out there all day doing that, and it wears you down.
Yeah, it takes a beating on you.
And, you know, even sneaking a beer once in a while in between.
That'll refresh you,
well,
right?
Well, maybe, you know, more than a beer, but it's a game that you do with.
Yeah,
you know,
sometimes it turns into 14-hour days.
It's a drinking kind of game, but, you know, everybody in the Quoit world really controls themselves so well. I mean, they're there to play the game, and, you know, you can't overdrink, because if you do, you're going to see two pins, and what are you going to throw at?
That's why I got two quoits, right?
You know, yeah. But anyway, that's the way it is. I guess we can go to clip one to show, you know, the first actual showing at the Quoit Pits. And that's how it's set up in the beginning. A lot of work goes into it, getting everything lined up, and depending upon the number of entry teams, determines the amount of pits that they use. It's usually 20 pits will handle, you know, 60 teams.
Yep.
And, you know, if there's 80 teams, you might need 25 pits. But, you know, each one is set up exactly the same as the other one.
It looks like Hollywood's getting ready to throw there.
Yeah.
Okay, yep. It's I think it's a good spectator sport as well. It's fun to watch, you know, good players pitching. People shake their heads like, I don't know how that person does it. How does he get all those ringers on there? Or, you know, and it's repeat. It's not luck. I mean, it is definitely a skill set that, you know, that you guys have learned very well. And a number of others have learned that, and, you know.
Yeah, you know, there's been a whole bunch of times I've gotten knocked out of tournaments early and then just stayed till the end, because, you know, you're rooting.
You want to see what's going on. You know, it's I can't imagine that it's very often that you're knocked out early, but
if you see
how happened. You guys pitch. But, you know, it happens. If you get somebody that's really hot and, you know, your game is maybe 80% there or something, that's all it takes, that little bit of difference.
Just a little bit.
Boom, they're, you know.
One shot, that's it.
Yeah, you mentioned we're ringer throwers. There's a lot of ringer throwers now, so you got to know when to throw them.
Right.
And plenty of times I've made bad choices at the wrong time and throw a ringer when I shouldn't and got
then
popped, lose
you're,
the game.
You're giving them 6 points instead of three.
Yeah.
Or nine, and, you know, instead of six. It's amazing.
But if you don't go for it, then you're sorry.
Yeah.
right. Do you ever throw, you know, in some of your ringer strategies or your playing strategies, do you ever throw the upside down quoit?
To kind of
protect a ringer that's already on there that you're scoring with, and the next guy doesn't top you, so you throw your second ringer upside down to try and, you know, provide a place where if it gets on there, it's like a clamshell and it bounces off more easily than topping another ringer.
Yeah, it's usually towards the end of the game.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? When, say okay. we have 18, they have 15, you throw that last quoit ringer and you don't want them to top it.
No. Yeah.
I believe Sean Hirsch, I've done that 3 or 4 times too. I think he's the only one I've gotten with that.
Really?
Yeah.
From 15 right to 21 with the topper. Yeah. Well, we lost Danville like that about 5 or 6 years ago.
Yeah.
Came in second with Ryan Peterson and I were partners.
Yeah, and I remember that.
Yeah. But they were good. This past weekend was the 724.
Yep.
And you repeated a win on that one.
Yeah,
you won the Worlds the week before. And then the 724, which takes place down in Pottstown on Route 724.
Yep.
You know, right off of that. And how many teams were there this week?
We had 15 teams.
Yeah, 15.
15 teams there.
15 teams.
15 teams.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, this was actually our fifth win.
Some of the best
there.
Players go to that tournament.
Oh, yeah.
So
yeah,
it's
all the normal guys.
It's a fight all the way through. There's no easy games.
Yeah, we went 5-5 in pool play.
Incredible.
Yeah.
5-5.
Yeah, to go and win the whole thing.
Yeah, but you guys seem to be able to turn it up a notch when you're, you know, when you need to.
Yeah, when we're down, we try to come right back up.
Tell you what, why don't we take a look at the final game of the Worlds. And we'll show that in clip 2, and you know, I think people will enjoy that. After that, we'll take some phone calls, and if anyone wants to know anything about quitting, we're happy to help them out.
Happy to answer. Yeah.
Sound good?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's do it.
Hi, we're here for the 2017 World Doubles Quoit Championship between.
That's Billy Conrad Jr. right there. I believe he won the singles 4 times in a row. When we first started?
4 or 5.
Four or five times
he did.
One of the best to ever play the game.
15 world champs. Here we are for game 2. If Ringdingers win it, they will be crowned the 2017 World Doubles Champions. If Mike Keebler-Johnston and Scott Yutz win, we will go to a game 3. Two tight ones in there. And Keebler bounces another one off the top of the pin.
Anybody have a flashlight?
We're looking for a flashlight, maybe measuring tools. In walks the referee, Beav Luckinbill. He is going to make the call. The gold one is in. That's Scotty Hall for the Ringdingers, and they have the 1-0 lead. Dan throws one just a touch short, maybe an inch or two. And Scott throws one tight to the pin. And Dan bounces one off the top. Scott's looking for more. And he throws a beauty in there, and he looks like he has 2. And he does. It's 2-1. Scott and Keeb. Keebler tight to the front of the pin. looking to find his hot streak. Scotty bounces one off. And another one off the top of the pin for Keebler. And Scotty has thrown another ringer to give them the 4-2 lead. Scotty's first ringer of this game. Dan is throwing deep. Scott throws his short a couple inches, but I think he's in. And then Dan throws one tight to the side. Scott throws one in the front. It's going to be a close one. Scott's is in for him and Keeb. 4-3 lead for the Ringdingers. Keebler tight to the pin again. He's starting to find his front of the pin shot. Scotty bounces off the top. Keebler comes up a bit short, but he's in for two. And he has the two, and now Keeb and Scott have the lead at 5-4. Scott throws, he's a little over an inch short. And Dan Carter has just thrown a ringer, his first of the game. Scott looking for the topper. He comes up a bit short. Dan is looking to get bonus points here. And he misses off to the side. He got the three for the ringer. And they take the 7-5 lead. Scotty Hall lays one tight to the front of the pin. Very good first, Quoit. Keebler, a ringer thrower, and is long overdue for one. He is struggling with his ringer shot as Scotty lays another one in. Keebler's ringer shot is snake bit right now. Scotty Hall has gotten two, and they extend their lead 9-5. Dan lays one off to the side about a half an inch. Scott's is a little short. They believe Dan may be closer. And he just bounces one off. And Scott bounces one off as well. They may have to measure. No, it is one for the Ringdingers, and they have a 10-5 lead. Scotty Hall lays one tight to the front of the pin. And again, Keebler bounces off. Scotty bounces off. And Keebler comes up just a bit short. And Ringdinger score another one and take the 11-5 lead. Ooh, bounces off the pin. Almost on. And a beautiful first shot for Scott. And Dan throws a ringer. This is a big shot early in the game. Oh! Bounces off the pin. Dan gets the three. They take a 14-5 lead, and they're starting to pull away. Good first shot by Scotty Hall. Tight to the front of the pin. Keebler bounces again. And Scotty just throws a ringer. He has 4 points land. These are huge. Off the pin again. Keebler is bouncing everything. He's all around the pin and just can't land one on. 18-5 ring dingers. Dan bounces off. Scott throws a semi-close. Dan, Scotty says, end it, put it on. He does! He puts it on. He does what his partner tells him. Scott has to top this to stay in the game. It is over the top, and it is over. 21-5, we have the world champion 2017 ring dingers. The fans are coming in to congratulate him. 21-5. Keebler just could not find his shot. Dan and Scotty started hitting some ringers, and they couldn't find their shot to top any of them. ...2015 champions, now 2017 champions, ring dingers. Hi, we're here with the 2017 World Doubles Champion, ring dingers. To my left, to my right, we have the runner-up, Mike Johnston and Scott Yutz. First ring dingers. How did you feel the first game they jump out? I think it was 8-0 on you guys. When did you think that you were going to... turn this on and come back and win it.
That's the game plan. You know, every time you get down, you get fired up. You start hitting ringers. This man right here. Oh, yeah, that's what's up.
Oh, I know Scotty Hall hits the ringers.
You forgot 2015 and 2017 world champs, though.
Just go for every time. That's what we do. And hopefully, yeah, that's what we do, you know. Try to
do. You really jumped out on him in game two. You took a big lead. I think you were up like 18-0. Dan has a second Quoit. I heard you tell him, Scotty, you said go for it. Worried, not worried, thinking put it away now?
Never worried, just try to go for it. What happens, happens.
Well, playing against these guys, the worry is always there whenever you hit ringers, you know. You always think you're going to get top when you throw a ringer.
What about Keeb? He's a ringer thrower, too. He bounced a lot off the top of the pin. Seems like Scotty took advantage of that pretty much.
Different game when the lights come out, sun goes away, you know. I struggle with it. He struggles with it. Everybody struggles with that.
Yeah.
Hey, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Hey, guys, you were in game one. You jumped out to a big lead, and they come back, and you let it slip away.
That's what they do. They're probably the best people here. I just kept it bouncing off the top. Not much to do.
Do you think the light affected you, the darkness?
Definitely. I mean, we throw in the lights on Thursdays, but it's a different.
Scott, you look pretty good in game one, and you just maybe needed a topper maybe or something to get back in it, or?
Well, I'm the shortest guy out here. I probably had trouble getting it there to the pin, so I should be able to stand at the front of the pit, but.
Oh, 21 feet, huh? Hey, once again, hey, congratulations, guys. You threw well today.
Well, guys, job well done. Congratulations to both of you. You guys are an excellent team together. I think you know, when one guy's maybe off a little bit, the other guy picks him up, and vice versa. And that's what makes, you know, an outstanding team.
Yeah, you know, we've been friends since we were 15. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah, we're going on 15 years of friendship now. So it kind of makes the Quoit bond
wonderful. And Quoits came into your lives, and it really made it solid. Excellent. Well, as I said in the beginning of the show, we're going to take phone calls if we, you know, we don't have a lot of time left. But if anyone wants to call in, find out more about Quoiting, it's 610-378-0426 is our number. And we have a few minutes that we'll try to take any calls that may come in. But I didn't really realize that you guys went back that far, that you were friends that long. And, you know, see, you knew each other pretty darn well, and you know what to expect out of the other guy at the other end, you know, because it's more than just the Quoits. It's also that camaraderie and picking up your partner when he's down or when he's feeling down or when he's, you know, just off a little bit.
Yeah, you know.
You guys have won so many tournaments.
Yeah, he wouldn't throw with me for the first year I started throwing because I was that bad.
Yeah, I got him into
it. I didn't want to throw with you either. I used to pick your name on Friday night, and oh, my God. I thought, oh, no, Dan Carter. And, you know, he was just starting, though. Everybody starts out like that.
Yeah.
You know, but no one that I know started like you did. And pitch the way you do now.
Just incredible. Kept up with it and kept playing, and here we are.
Yep. Did you give him any lessons at all, or any pointers, Scott? Because you were, first time I ever met you, you were pretty darn good at that time. So you must have pitched before, you know, you came on the Quoit scene with us.
Yeah, I started pitching when I was 12. My stepdad got me into it, and I think at 20 when I met Dan Clare and you up at Moton.
Okay, and I remember that first night.
Yeah.
You and I won up there already.
Yes, Billy Cole and I won the first time I was up there.
Okay.
And I started getting Dan into it.
Yeah.
And a couple of years later, we started going to Quoit tournaments and stuff, and excellent. Here we are.
And the rest is history. That's excellent.
Yeah.
That's really, that's a neat story. You know, it always adds a little bit more. I don't know if they got a shot of the pictures or not, the trophies of the two of you. On 2015 USQA World Champion and the Iron Heritage in Danville.
Yeah, that's up in
Champions. Danville. Right. That's one that I was, you know, won in 2007.
Yeah.
A little bit before
that. That was before I came in, I think.
Yeah, probably. But it's a nice tournament, and of course the Worlds, you know, and those are great pictures. They're nice plaques to have, you know, forever. Hang them up in your family room and so forth. Okay. You know, like I said earlier, we're willing to take some phone calls. It's 610-378-0426. Anything else that you gentlemen want to add to, you know, any Quoiting stories that you recall that, you know, while we're waiting for a caller, but they're not calling, so we, you know, we have a little bit of extra time.
I'd like to say this coming weekend, we do have two Quoit tournaments coming up if you want to come out and join us.
Okay.
One's out in Denver, if you want to come out there.
Mm-hmm.
And there's another one, Bark for Life. It's a charity tournament in Ole.
Oh, yes.
Ole Fairgrounds.
Yeah.
Okay. Do they support cancer?
Yeah.
In that one?
Yes.
Okay. I know a couple of the tournaments, you know, they're fundraisers, and everything that they get is donated to the Cancer Society. And I think that's wonderful. I want to see that disease wiped out, you know, in my grandchildren's lives or my children's lives. At any rate, thank you for tuning in, and we'll see you again in the Quoit Pits.